Thank you for watching this Understanding Project today on the fruits of the Spirit. I want to tell you, this is probably one of the most self-revealing messages I've spoken a long time, where you actually begin to realize the flesh at work in your life and the Spirit at work in your life. And so I really want to encourage you to watch today's message. I also want you to be encouraged that this is just a fun message. It's going to get a point across, but it's something you'll never forget. And it will explain the fruit of the Spirit in a way that I believe you can apply to your life. I hope that you enjoy this Understanding Project on the fruit of the Spirit and understanding how God is revealed in us and how we must be attached. We must have the Spirit of God flowing, attached to the vine. And as we are, life can come from us. We can either be someone attached to Christ, being led by the Spirit, or attached to the flesh. This is a choice that each and every one of us must make. If we do not abide in the vine, then we will not have the life that God provides for us, that we can give to others. And so I want to encourage you to realize that this message is one that you must hear and understand. We also have a part two. We'll be dealing with a second aspect of this and getting down to the fruit and how it looks in your life. So enjoy today's message on this Understanding Project. Thank you for supporting. Thank you for being a part of this ministry. And I hope that this encourages you and helps you understand so you can learn, live, and give the gospel as we do it together as the body of Christ.
I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman or vine dresser. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away, and every branch that bears fruit, he prunes it that it may bear more fruit. What does he do? God says, I prune it. I prune it. I want you to learn something today so you can live it. If you're already living it, I want you to learn something today so you can give it. Why? Because this message is about giving things. When you're going through a tough time, here's what. Sometimes it's because you're not abiding in Christ. Other times it's because this hurts. That hurts. Someone just clip your arm off. That would hurt. Yeah. Talk to Bill Meyer, man. Just cut your face. Then you'd know. You know, it hurts. I just want to say that just because we live for God, everything isn't easy and everything doesn't go our way all the time. Really important. And the pruning of God sometimes hurts, but it's like discipline. It brings forth more fruit. It brings forth good. See, some of us have bought into some lies, and the lies are this, that if we don't discipline our children, it's because we love them. The Bible says just the opposite. You don't love your children if you don't discipline them. The world says, you don't really need to discipline them much. Be kind, be nice. That's all good. You should be kind. You should be nice. You should love. But real love is going to discipline your children in love, correct discipline. Because why? Because you love them, and there's certain things in their life that need to be out. Well, God prunes you for the same reason. There's some things in your life he doesn't want there because they hurt you. So he brings a pruning process and cuts things out of your life. First service last week and this week, we talked about sucker limbs. How many have ever pruned a tree? Yeah, I know very little about pruning trees. I've given up on that a long time ago. My dad used to try to teach me about pruning trees. I've learned that a chainsaw works better. If you just hack off everything as fast as possible and hope that the thing still lives tomorrow, that works for me. So I, every couple of years, I'll tell you the really beautiful thing. When you cut all these little limbs like this, like you're supposed to, the bummer is you got to pick them all up. If you just take it off like right there, you can just carry the whole big limb over and throw it in the fire. It's awesome. Awesome. But don't, so understand, in theory, I know a little bit about pruning. In reality, when you come to my house, I'm going to look a little hypocritical, okay? Because I just hack those things off. So here's what happens is they're sucker limbs. All of us have them. This tree came from my yard. You kind of get the point? I said to my wife, I said, honey, actually I was a little scared. So I sent one of my kids in to ask if I could cut a tree out of the front yard. back was, he's crazy. Whatever. Just whatever. And then she said, it'll be great. I won't have to mow around it. You can tell our house is interesting. So, you know, if you cut all the trees down, you don't have to mow around them. So, yeah, go ahead. Cut them down. So for all you that are tree lovers and tree huggers, you know, have at it. After service, you can hug it. You can bury it. You can do anything to it because I'm throwing it away. But I did cut this tree down. Yes, if it's alive, I did kill it, okay? But don't worry, because I know how to plant a new one right near it. I do, I promise. So here's the problem is we have sucker limbs. Sucker limbs cause the fruit that grows on the limb to not get the nourishment it needs. See, we have some sucker things in our lives that suck the life out of us, and they're problems, habits, sometimes they're people. From first service, somebody said, how do you cut family out of your life? Because they're sucking the life out of you. Well, I'm going to tell you something. There's some family in our lives that we need to show the love of God to, but we need to cut out if they're draining us. Remember, we're light, and we bring light to darkness. If you start to realize that darkness is invading the light, we got problems. If they're causing you to be hidden, that's a problem. And so we got some sucker things in our lives that needs to be clipped. When they get clipped like that, what happens is now the rest of the branch can grow better and stronger. Thing's starting to cut on its own. This is a little scary. So listen to what it goes on to say. So you, every branch that bears fruit, he prunes, that it may bring forth more fruit. So we think that if we're getting pruned, if things are being taken away, we feel like God must be judging us. Something bad is going on, right? I mean, that's what happens. You start to feel like, God, where are you? No, it's because you're bringing forth fruit. You're doing a good job. And God says, oh, you can do better. Don't you love that? Oh, this could be better for you. So when you start to produce fruit, that's when the pruning process is going to really begin to happen. He's going to develop character in you. He's going to develop who you are as a person. And he's going to start taking things away, and it's going to start being a little painful. Okay? And I don't know if you've ever had that happen, but boy, howdy have I. Now listen to what it says. Verse 3. You are already clean because of the word which I have spoken to you. Abide in me, and I in you, and every branch, or a branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine. Neither can you unless you abide in me. Now, this is vital to understand. So many times, we think that we can change our fruit. We can increase our fruit. The problem is that we can't just increase fruit unless we're abiding in the vine. So he says, the righteousness, you're already made whole because of what I've spoke to you. You've already been made righteous. You're already tapped into the vine. Now, I want to explain to you what is all being said there in this way. Some of you have heard the message, which in this series I've addressed about the trichotomy of man, being made in the image of God, how we are made in the image of God. So what happens is here I am, mind, will, and emotions, soul. Mind, will, and emotions. I must be led. Cover this real quick. You can go back and listen to that message, Made in the Image of God, online. I must be led. My mind does not lead. I'm not an intellectual being that I'm led solely by the mind. You might think so. You might want that to happen. It just isn't true. Mind, will, emotions. Emotions aren't bad necessarily. What you think isn't bad necessarily. Your makeup, mind, will, and emotions isn't bad, but it must be led. It'll be led by the flesh or it'll be led by the spirit. The choice is really going to be up to you. So as a believer, what happens is this. What makes me righteous initially is what? Is when my spirit that the Bible says is dead in trespasses and sin. That doesn't mean I'm not spirited. That doesn't mean I'm not excitable. It just means this. My spirit is dead in trespasses and sin. That means I don't have a direct connection with God. I kind of like an Old Testament believer. I can call out to God. He might do something. He might work in my life. But my spirit's not just connected and alive. Okay? So truth is, like it or not, I'm kind of like a branch. Dead. The Bible talks about it being tossed by every wind and wave of doctrine. You know, what someone might get up and preach or say, you know, just tosses you around. Storms blow you over and kick you around. That's how we live our lives. What is the essence of being born again? That we are grafted in to Christ and we begin to receive life from him by the Holy Spirit. Whose spirit is the Holy Spirit? It's God's spirit. Holy, meaning deity or divine, God's Holy Spirit. It's the Spirit of God flowing through us. It's from God on the throne. He's a three-part being, but understand, it's all about our understanding of who he is. God is wanting to move through us, and he moves through the Word of God by his Spirit to bring life to us. So what happens is my mind, will, and emotions needs to be grafted in to God. Jesus is trying to explain this by taking a tree and saying, see this tree? It needs to be pruned. As we cut off some of these dead limbs and these things and these areas, we're going to cause strength to grow to those who will abide in me. So Christians, we've got lots of Christians out there. They've said the sinner's prayer. And you were made righteous by that. You can't earn it. But remember the little thing we like to say all the time? It's not about religion. This is about a relationship. Right? Isn't that what we say? Oh, we're not religious like that. We're not about religion. We're not about dead works. We're about a relationship. Here's the deal, guys. This represents a relationship. Do you abide in Jesus? Are you connected to the Spirit of God? Or have you cut yourself off and now you're dying? See, I cut this tree down, and by the time I drove from I cut it down, put it in the back of my truck and drove here. By the time I got here, it was already looking dead. Because the life source is in the trunk and then down into the roots where it begins to drink, pull life. And we're Christians out here trying to live like this. Come on, somebody pour some water on me. Let me see if I can get a little dirt. We're just like dying for little morsels of something to bring life, calling ourselves Christians. But that's the problem. What's happening is, ultimately, we're being led by the flesh instead of the Spirit. So when you accept Christ, your spirit is now alive unto God, but it's what you do with it. It's a relationship that causes your life to be like Christ and to bring forth fruit. I'm not even addressing whether or not you're going to heaven or hell. That's not even my issue. It's not even what we're talking about today. I'm not going to try to, you know, tell you whether you're going to heaven or hell, because right now I don't even really, honestly, let's go beyond that. Let's live the life God's called us to live. Let's receive the benefits. You know why? Because everything around us is difficult. It's not easy. This world we live in is not easy. And so what God is saying is, don't be grafted into the church. This is the church. The whole tree's the church. Every branch. And we've all got to be connected into Jesus. And when we are, we begin to derive life, not from each other, but from him. And then what do? We begin to receive the very best that God has for us. And let's go on just a little bit further. Abide in me and I in you. As a branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him bears much fruit. For without me, you can't do anything. That's Jesus saying that. So what he's saying is if you're not being led by the Spirit, born again, we don't like that term, do we? I love it. Born again. I'm a born again Christian. Let the whole world know it. I'm not afraid of it. I'm not ashamed of it. Because if I'm not born again, I am trying to live in my soul man in a love that is not directed by God. It is totally just whatever you can do for me. If you're good to me, I'm good to you kind of a thing. That's not God. God goes way beyond that. And we're being led by whatever feels good, do it. The flesh. We live our lives all about us, about what I get out of it. But here's the reality is when we become alive unto God, we begin to derive the very best that God has for us. We have to begin to understand that this is about a relationship of being connected to God. Verse 6, if anyone does not abide in me, he is cast out as a branch that is withered and has gathered them, men gather them and throw them into the fire and they are burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, you can ask what you desire. Listen to this. Ask whatever you desire and it shall be done for you. Yeah. Ah, man. Papa needs a new car. That's not what it's talking about. He's saying that if you're led by the Spirit, you're going to want what God wants. You're not going to ask amiss. You're going to ask what God wants. You're going to want what God wants. This is not a get rich, you know, preacher trying to get stuff out of you and trying to tell you that if you give money, you're going to get rich. That's not what this scripture is about. What he's saying is this. When you're connected to me, all the provision you need is there. I'll walk you through anything. I'll do it. But you've got to be led by the Spirit, connected, drawing your life from Christ. What does that mean? Let's get back to a prayer life. What does that mean? Let's get back to reading our Bibles. What does that mean? Let's begin to have a relationship with Jesus Christ that brings forth fruit that causes people to come to your life and eat from it. By this, my Father is glorified that you bear much fruit, so you will be my disciples. As the Father loved me, so have I loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may remain in you and your joy may be full. This is my command, that you love one another as I have loved you. And if you go back to that message on love, it will totally just be amazing right there. Greater love has no man than this, that he lays down his life for his friend. Remember, that doesn't mean I die for my friend only. That means I give up what's best for me for somebody else. That one's a hard one, this world and economy, isn't it? But it's God's best. Greater love has no one than this, than he lays down his life for his friends. You are my friend if you do what I command you. No longer do I call you servant, because a servant does not know what his master is doing, but I call you friend. For all things I have heard from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I have chosen and appointed you that you should go forth and bear fruit, and that your fruit shall remain. And whatever you ask of my Father in my name, I will give it to you. These things I command you, that you love one another. See, folks, God has called us to be grafted into him and that we're a branch that grows. He prunes up the things in our life that suck the life out of us, that we could truly receive all that God has and we could have good, good fruit. But what's the problem? Well, here's the problem, folks. It's not only that we can bear good fruit, we also can bear bad fruit. Galatians chapter 5 talks about good fruit and bad fruit. Let's read it in Galatians chapter 5 verse, we'll try 13. For you, brethren, have been called to liberty. You're free in Jesus. There is no law concerning the fruit of the Spirit. You've been called to liberty as an opportunity for the flesh, but through love serve one another. For all the law is fulfilled in one word, even this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. You know why he says that? Because I don't care who you are, you love yourself. Even people who come to the point of suicide, they're really just loving themselves. They're not loving anyone else. They're just loving them. It's not that you have self-hatred. Sorry. I go down the list. It all comes back to we have a problem. We love ourselves so much. God's saying, listen, if you want to love me, love somebody else. If you want to agapeo me like I agapeo love you, then you agapeo love somebody else. Again, another message you need to listen to. But if you bite and devour one another, beware lest you be consumed by one another. Because that's what happens. Anytime I see people get all upset and do their little, oh, we're going to do our thing, and it's our thing, I feel so sorry for them. Because it's just a matter of time, they're going to tear themselves up. Oh, they may be right, but they're still wrong. You ever been right and still wrong? Oh, yeah. Oh, howdy. Then I say, walk in the Spirit, and you will not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the lust of the flesh lusts against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. They are contrary to one another, so that they do not do the things that you wish. Folks, I want to tell you, mind, will, and emotion have to be led. It'll be led by the Spirit or led by the flesh. If you're going to be confusing to people. Dazed and confused. That's the problem. Us Christians, we look like we've been smoking the doobie just a little too much. Because we're walking around dazed and confused. We got fruit that is smelly and nasty, calling ourselves Christians. People are eating of it. They're just like, oh my God. That's nasty. That ain't Jesus. That's what's happening. You want that one, honey? She's the only one that'll take that one. So, Here's the reality. We walk in the flesh. We're going to have fruit from the flesh. If you see fruit from the flesh in your life, which we're going to read in a second, you know the problem is you're not being abiding in Christ. Your relationship with Christ isn't right. And if you're trying to, then you need to begin to say, God, prune this. Let's take this thing out. This doesn't look like you. This isn't what's going to taste good, be good. It's not going to cause me to be healthy. There's things sucking the life out of me. Let's clip them. Listen to what it says. It gives you a list. I mean, the Bible's so plain. It gives you a list. For the flesh lusts after the Spirit, and the Spirit after against the flesh. These things are contrary. They don't go together. When you're a Christian, it's like dazed and confused. You're all messed up. Verse 18. But if you're led by the Spirit, you're not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are evident. They're adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lewdness. You know what? I don't care who you are. You've had these in your life. Sorry. You've had these in your life. The question is, you going to let them be your past and move on to the best that God has? Just because you've been led by the flesh in the past doesn't mean you have to remain there. Doesn't mean you have to let your family keep you there. It doesn't mean that has to be your reputation forever. You know what the best thing about repentance is? It's a time to turn around. It is a point of change. It is a time to say, that was then, and this is now. And I want to tell you, as Christians, we have to live repentance. When we see that we need an adjustment, make the adjustment. Don't wait for you to have to do a full circle. Like driving down the road, whether you realize it or not, you're constantly making adjustments. Make little adjustments all the time, and you'll get where you planned on going. Religion says, here's how you do it. It locks you in, and you end up driving off the road. Why? Because you can't stay on the road. Because this, as a rule book, will kill you. When it's the law, you break, you die. This, as the nature of God, will bring life to you. This, as the will of God for your life, will begin to bring life to you. This, the Word and the Spirit, work together. That doesn't mean that this isn't exactly right. It means that without the Holy Spirit, you can never live it. You must be anchored in. So many people are living a religious life. They're really just being led by the flesh. They're trying to do good works. They're trying to make it good. They're getting a mantra. They're doing it. But they never find the fruit of the Spirit. Oh, they find little bits and pieces for a while, but it never is a flow. The difference between happiness and joy. Big difference. There's a difference between brotherly love and agapeo love. There's a difference between waiting a little while and patience. We'll get there. We probably won't get there, but it would be nice if we did. We'll get there next week. I'm going to do this one more week. If you are led by the Spirit, you're not in the law, but the works of the flesh are evident, which is adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lewdness, idolatry, sorcery, hatred, contentiousness, jealousness, outbursts of wrath, selfish ambitions. Are we starting to, dissensions, heresy, is this starting to sound like us? Envy, murder, drunkenness, revelry, and the like. Oh, the list is a little too long for me to name them all. Does this sound like you? You know what? That isn't a Budweiser commercial that we can all laugh at. Here's what he's saying. If this is going on in your life, that's not the problem. The problem is, it's a result of where you're connected. And it looks good. Lust of the flesh. Feels good. And it brings forth death. Here's the interesting thing. Who's it killing? When you're connected to the flesh, you're already dead. Who's it killing? You're living by the flesh, who's it killing? Who's eating your fruit killing? Everyone who eats of it. Your children. Your marriage. It just takes one person to eat of the flesh to start hurting everyone around them. You know what happens is, my parents ate of the flesh. So I guess I will. And at some point, we choose, hopefully, to be grafted into the Spirit of God. Listen to what that is. Here's the fruit of that. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy. Next week I'm going to give you a handout. It'll have these all defined. Peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such there's no law. And those who are of Christ have crucified the flesh and the passions and the desires thereof, and they live in the Spirit. So let us walk in the Spirit. I've accepted Christ. I want to be Christ-like. So now I'm grafted in. So what do? Start receiving from God. Well, I would, but I'm so busy. I mean, I come home, I'm tired, I just turn on the TV. That's not receiving from God. Well, and I'm on the way to work, you know, I just like to have some music, so I turn on the secular music station. You're not receiving from God. Well, I went to some of my friends who aren't really Christians. They don't have good fruit. And it's good to be around people with bad fruit, so it makes your fruit seem better. You know? You ever stink? I've stunk before. I'm working really hard, you start to stink. It's really good to go up to somebody who's worked a little harder, maybe showered, because you start to smell good. Everybody starts to think it's them that stinks. I won't say anything about farting, but you know, if I did, you'd know what I mean, you know? Truth is, our bad fruit, we start to take company with the bad fruit. We like to smell like the bad fruit, but you know what? There's no life in it. It's just death, and we're tossed around. We can call ourselves anything we want. It's being abiding in God, and then the fruit begins to happen. So here's what is beautiful about it. our children begin to eat. I can't eat this because this is not on my diet, but if it was, I would eat it. It's really good. They begin to eat of our fruit. The people at work, they begin to eat of our fruit. They begin to take and eat of our fruit. This week, I went into one store, and as I went in a couple different times, I had people say, hey, you know what? So-and-so goes to your church, don't they? Yeah. Oh, man, they're really Christians. You know why? Because they had taken, and they had taken a bite from you and tasted Christ. Here you go, guys. Oh, there you go. Good catch. They had taken and eaten, and they were tasting Christ. See, that's the problem is preachers' kids rebel. Do you know why? Oh, there's lots of reasons. But do you know one of the bad reasons? The bad one is because they don't see at home what they hear preached from the pulpit. You know what? Some people get real upset with me because they say, well, Pastor, sometimes you're just too honest. And you say things that I don't think is probably good for the building of the church because you tell where you like totally blow it. This week, on Thursday, I had one of those. Thursday really was not a good day. Thursday, I had a lot of appointments. None of them seemed to be good. I think it was Thursday. Oh, it was Wednesday. Oh, yeah, church day. That's right, it was Wednesday. It was just a lot of stuff all day. And then I got a new cell phone. I don't know about you, but new cell phones, whew, that ain't good. And by the time I went home Wednesday night, I was not in a good way. For you up close, you could hear my mom, you could hear my wife, the mother of my unborn child. Say amen to that. I didn't beat nobody up, I'm none of that kind of stuff, but I probably would have if that would have been my thing. I just was done. Just done. And I began, yeah, I'm a Christian, I'm born again, I've had daily devotions, I'm good. But you know what? I began to operate in the flesh. I just said, well, done. Come 9 o'clock, I come home, and I walk in the house, and I got company. We're there. Everyone's having a good time. They're making food. That doesn't set well with me right now because I'm on a diet. So they're eating. It didn't make me happy. I walk in, my son, I got him this little game that like shoots deer like on the ceiling and then you shoot at him. Boy, I'm politically correct today, aren't I? And so the deer jump up and you shoot him. And it's not working right, so it's just like, it's not supposed to make that noise, you know? And I'm just like, walk in. I've already had it. I was already mad when I got there. Walk in, I'm just like, oh. So, pick up the game. So we're just going to let him just sit here and a three-year-old ruin the game? Toss the game. I can't fix the game, so I toss it across the room. I just go to my room. That was the fruit of the Spirit, wasn't it? Aren't you glad? You know what? I'd rather tell you the truth than lie to you and have my kids out there think. I'd rather tell you the truth and be honest to them and to you. So you at least know what you get. I'd rather be honest and then repent. Be honest and repent and turn and live the right way. What I realized is I was wrong. But it kept going. Why? Because I was enjoying the fruit of the flesh. I was getting gratification out of this. I went and I laid down on my bed and I put my computer. I said, work to do. I said, hours worth of work to do. My kids, everybody wants to make it better. So they open the door. Not a good idea. My daughter's first words are, "Hey, Dad, I'll show you how to." You know, we had to buy all these. We did a whole new phone contract so we could save money. And now I got this stupid phone I don't know how to use. Oh no, they're great. They can do. Oh, shut up. You know. So my daughter comes in, "Dad, hey, let me show you how to use your phone." I'm like, "No, I do not." "Okay, Dad." My son walks in. "Hey, Dad, I fixed that game that was broken." That's just beautiful. Maybe we could have just not broke it. My wife, much greater wisdom, walks in quietly, stands for a little while, and walks out. My fruit was kind of like this. How many like this? You want this orange? Who wants the orange? Come on, raise some hands. Oh, yeah. It was kind of like this. There you go, Keith. Oh, be careful. All right. So that's the kind of fruit it was. Little contaminated. With what? The flesh. What was happening? My children were eating from that fruit. They were eating from that fruit. Folks, I had to get reconnected. I had to get reconnected. I couldn't just change the outward. Yes, you can do that, but the problem really wasn't the outward. The problem wasn't the circumstances. The problem wasn't this, and the problem wasn't that. The problem was the winds began to blow. The storm was there. And I allowed myself to not abide in Christ. Do you see what I'm saying? And so because of that, I can't, listen, I can't have good fruit. Until I abide in Christ, I can't, I can try, it's fake. It doesn't taste good, it's going to be... So all of us are here today. We're all being real today, right? The only way to have good fruit is abide in Christ. Everything else will eventually lead to death. It might taste good for a while. It might seem good for a while. But eventually, it's going to bring forth death. It all leads to death. But Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. All men, all, are going to have to abide in him. And then, when we eat, it can bring forth life. Then, when people, who eats of our fruit? Everyone around us. Love, joy, patience, kindness, goodness, self-control. See, I wasn't, you know. I had some self-control. I could have been worse. But I didn't have enough. I wasn't being led by him. You know, you want to really get down right down to it? It's all. Our whole lives, everything we do, everything. It really comes down to this. Be led by the Spirit. Every day, all the time. And if you do, then everything and everyone around you are going to start eating of Christ. You want to be a good evangelist? Don't worry about preaching it all the time. Because, see, remember, learn it. You gotta take it in. How are they going to know if there's not a preacher? How are they going to know if the word doesn't go forth? The word of God doesn't return void. Learn. Live. I didn't get this out of a textbook. I waited on God. And God, these were for us. Live. Start applying it first to me. Start living it out. And what happens is, as I live in Christ, I have something to give. I have something good to give. Whoa, there you go. That was actually change of course right in the middle. I told you it's dangerous around here. I have something to give. There you go. That was what I meant to do. And you like oranges. See, I can give this stuff. And it begins to bring life to everyone around me. All of a sudden, it tastes good. All of a sudden, it is good. Think about this for a minute. This is what God is wanting of the church. This is what he wants. He desires this of us. It's good to sit up front, up close, huh? Yeah? See? Yeah, don't step on the grapes, okay? Because there's going to be a lot of cleaning. Then my testimony starts to mean something. Do you see what I'm saying? This is what God, it says, God is glorified when we begin to bring forth much fruit. Why? Because everybody needs Jesus, and Jesus is found in good fruit. Folks, this is what the world needs. So here's, look at what's happening with our children. Here's what they do. They go, wow, Dad, I feel stronger. Wow, this is good for me. And see, it starts to bring forth life so that somebody else says, wow, please hear this, church. I want to do more than go to church and receive something from the preacher. Wow, I want to be grafted into the vine. Where's he getting this fruit from? They start looking for Christ. They start wanting Christ. But to do so, you have to be defined in character. To do so doesn't mean you got to be perfect. It means you got to be real. And you don't fix it by just absence of bad. You fix it by grafted into the root. So here's the problem. Problem is, people are also eating of this. You know what that is? It's rotten. You don't give it when you're ready, and you don't grow the wrong fruit. You're a Christian. Can you imagine biting into that? Is this the people at your work? Is this what they're tasting? That's what they're tasting, and it's gross. So here's the problem. If you've grafted into the fruit of the flesh, you're of no use, and you're bringing forth death. So if you're not going to be in Christ, religion won't do it. If you're not going to be in Christ and you call yourself attached but you're not bringing forth fruit, I don't cut you out. I got people worried about if I'm going to kick them out, worried about if I love them or if I don't love them. I love you. The very capacity I have, I love you. I don't kick out anybody unless there's a real problem. You'd have to really cause disruptions. God, on the other hand, he loves you enough to remove you rather than have you suck the life out of everyone else and be deceived that you're serving God when you're not. So this is what it says. It says that if you're a limb and you're not abiding into Christ, he'll cut you off. That isn't something to fear me about. But you need to have a holy fear of God that you want to produce fruit and glorify God. Otherwise, everybody eating of that rotten fruit you have is being misled that that's Christ and it isn't. He's going to expose you to not be who you're saying you are, that you're not really a Christian, you're saying you are and you're not. You say, well, then I'm just going to live in the world. You know, the problem with living in the world is this. Here's the problem. When you live in the world, you're actually grafted into a tree that brings death. You know what he does to trees that bring death? He does this. Told you we'd have fun today. All right, you guys, better sit down, not eat of the dead fruit. So now, I did this illustration because I don't think you'll ever forget it. But the illustration's not enough. Do you hear me? The illustration's not enough. We have to choose to be grafted in. Just listen. When we miss who we're grafted into, we're going to bring forth death to our families. It should be, in all honesty, it's fruit of the flesh or it's fruit of the spirit. Next week, I'm going to define each one of the things of the Spirit because I want you to be able to simply look at your life and judge it. Is this Jesus or not? If it isn't, I can't change the fruit, but what I can do is abide more in Christ. See, this is a stage. But when I was a kid, these were altars. It's where we went to change our life, where we were getting to give, willingly give up things and say, God, I'm done. It's where we sought the face of God. But we've progressed beyond that. That's what we think. But really what we've done is we've grafted into the wrong, the religious tree instead of the Jesus tree. We've yielded our lives to the things of the flesh and to religion instead of to a relationship with Jesus Christ that brings forth life. See, everybody is hurt. Please hear this. Everybody is hurt when people eat from the wrong tree. Adam and Eve, they ate from the wrong tree. The one that they thought was going to be best for them turned out to be death for all of us. What tree are you grafted into? What tree are you eating from? That's the question. If you got a tree that's the flesh, quit holding on to it. Just quit. Because it's bringing death to you and everyone around you. Cut it down. And let it be cast into the fire. Quit holding on to all your bad garbage. Let it be cast in the fire. And begin to say, God, I want your life. I want the best you have for me. I'm tired of doing what I think's right. My mind, my will, my emotions, led by the flesh. God, I want to know what's right in you. You know, don't even go to the Bible and go, here's all the list of rights. Start with just loving Jesus. Start with just saying, yeah, but eventually you're going to have to get to his word. Because you can't leave it out. Because he says, my name and my word were one. You can't love me and avoid what I've told you. Because that's my nature. See, there's good and there's bad. It isn't because I think so or you think so or don't think so. It's because God says it. He knows what's right, and he knows what's wrong. And we live in a world that there is no right and wrong anymore, but there still is. The Bible does say that we judge each other's fruit. I'll hear this, and then I'm going to close. It not only says we do, it says we're supposed to. Did you? Oh, don't judge me. I'm not supposed to judge your intentions. I'm not supposed to judge whether you're even saved or not. But I am required, if I'm going to have a relationship with you, if I'm going to open up and allow you to speak into my life, I'm required to look at your fruit. Is the fruit of your life good? Or is the fruit of your life bad? I believe that you can enter into God's very best, but you have to abide in Him. You have to be connected to Him. It's not about doing right or doing wrong. It's about abiding in Him and being led by His Spirit, and then you'll do right. Then you'll have everything you want. Why? Because your wanter will change. You'll want the right things. Why? Because you're being led by Him. Next week, we're going to talk about each fruit, what it means. We don't have to wait till next week. Where are you at today? With every head bowed and every eye closed, I want to ask this simple thing. I'm going to ask two things. So the first one I'm going to ask very specific. If you do not know the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, you've never asked Him into your heart, or you at least know that you are far from Him, and today, right now, you would like to ask Him into your heart. If you know that you're away from Him and you just say, Lord, I want to start. I can't change anything. I don't even know how to change. All I do know is this. I need Jesus. I believe that He died for me, and I want to live for Him. Jesus didn't die, and it was over. He died. He rose again, and He is there making intercession by the Spirit so you can live, so you can be grafted in. If you want to begin a relationship with Jesus Christ today and you'd like someone to just simply pray with you and let you have a new beginning, I'm going to ask you to raise your hand. Is there anyone here that would say, Pastor, that's me. I see that hand. Anyone else? I see that hand back there. There's one over here. Anyone else would say, Pastor, that's me. Can I have some staff? I need three or four of you to come and stand, men and women, a couple on both sides. You know what's so beautiful about making a commitment to Christ? Maybe you raised your hand. You can put it down if you did. Maybe you didn't, but you know you need to be here. You know what's so beautiful about it? It's a new day. It's a new day. You get to just start fresh. If you're here today and you raised your hand, or maybe you didn't, but you know you should have, we want to pray with you. I'm going to ask you to come right now and just stand with these that are standing up here. They just would like to pray with you. If you raised your hand, just step out from where you're at. Don't be afraid. We just want to pray for you. Amen. I want to ask one more thing, though, because I think this has to do with almost every one of us. If you're a Christian, born again of the Spirit of God, but today you've been looking at your fruit, and you realize that everybody around you have been eating of you, and they've not been getting a good taste. You realize that maybe you're not really grafted in to Christ the way you should be, and thus, it just doesn't smell and taste the way it ought to. And today, you'd like to ask for God's help. You'd just like to say, God, would you help me? I want this relationship to be closer to you. I want to have good fruit. I want my children, my family, my friends to eat of me and taste you. I don't want to contaminate what's here. If you know your fruit's not what it ought to be, and you're just going to ask for God's help, and you want this to be a new day for you, stand to your feet right now. Come on. Come on, church. There should be almost every one of us. Stand to your feet. If you can, and raise your hand if you can't stand then. Do whatever you can. Because this fruit needs, a world is depending on this fruit. Heavenly Father, I pray for each one that stood. Lord, number one, I pray that this church would be a church full of intercessors, a church full of people who care and desire the very best that you have, God. They wouldn't settle for anything less, that they would move in your spirit and they would have the gifts of the spirit, and the fruit of the spirit would take up life and residence within them, and it would grow and flourish. God, prune everything that needs pruned, even if it hurts. Cut away things that, Lord, may even be precious to us, that we could bring forth what's precious to everyone around us. Lord, let our fruit remain. Let our fruit be much that you might be glorified. We ask this in your name. We thank you, oh God. Lord, let no one leave here today the same as when they came, but let a new day begin for them.
I hope you enjoyed it, and I know that you probably won't forget this message on the Understanding Project, the fruit of the Spirit. The goal of the Understanding Project is that we could learn, live, and give the gospel together as the body of Christ. And as we do that, we must know certain principles, and being able to gauge our life in understanding the fruit that comes from our life is so vital, so important. People being able to eat of our fruit is just such a momentous thing for each and every one of us, our children, our friends, our family, the people around us. They are going to eat of us. The question is, what is it going to taste like? Will it bring life or bring death to them? Will it bring Christ to them? My heart is that what you eat of my life would bring Christ. I know that in my life there's been failures. In my life there's been things I don't want people to eat of. All we can do is repent, have the Lord literally cut those things out of our lives that we might live and produce much fruit. If you do not know Christ as your Savior, I want to encourage you to call us or get a hold of us. We would love to just talk with you and pray with you and help you in coming to know Christ as your Savior. I hope that this project has been an encouragement to you. I encourage you to watch part two of the Fruit of the Spirit, the Understanding Project, because we're going to give a real way to analyze your life, just to really look and analyze your life through some very specific things. I hope that you'll enjoy it. I hope that it will help change who you are as a believer.
Crossfire World Outreach Ministries is supported by faithful monthly contributions from viewers like you. Please take time today to make your tax-deductible gift to Crossfire World Outreach Ministries, 942 28th Street, Springfield, Oregon, 97477.